Graham that was obtained by the New York Times. I'm holding it up here. It's honestly, it's hard to see because there's so many names on it, but it's payments. Matt Gaetz's picture is on it. Joel Greenberg, who's serving time, is on it with these payments. This was prepared by federal investigators. It's basically just a web of thousands of dollars of Venmo payments between Gaetz and a group of associates, friends, women he allegedly had drug-fueled sex parties with over a three-year time span.
So let's just say we're lawyers here. There's some questions we need to ask to poke holes at this thing. So witness credibility. Joel Greenberg. Greenberg is a convicted felon who pleaded guilty to multiple charges, including sex trafficking. So how could his testimony be trusted given his criminal record and potential motive to reduce his sentence by implicating others, especially of a higher status that could be politically motivated? Did Greenberg receive any leniency or reduced sentencing in exchange for implicating Gaetz? That's a big question to ask. And other witnesses, have the women testifying received financial or legal benefits in exchange for their cooperation? What evidence exists beyond witness testimony to corroborate these claims? If these witnesses claim Gaetz engaged in criminal activities, why didn't they report these events sooner? Is there concrete proof, like receipts, travel records, communications, showing that Gaetz knowingly paid for the travel of a minor across state lines? Because we've been hearing a lot of, oh, Venmo this, and this other person paid for it with Venmo for Gaetz, blah, 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 and nothing super concrete yet. Has any forensic evidence been presented, such as verified digital communications or bank records? The drug-fueled parties. What evidence confirms that Gaetz attended these parties and participated in illicit activities? Were the allegations of drug use corroborated by drug tests or reliable testimony from multiple individuals? Multiple. Or any at all? How were the PayPal payments through Nestor Galban's PayPal account linked to the alleged sexual favors? Were these payments explicitly tied to illegal activities, or could they have been misinterpreted? Why didn't the DOJ prosecute? If the DOJ concluded there wasn't enough evidence to prosecute Gaetz, why are these allegations being pursued now? Did the DOJ identify flaws in the credibility of witnesses or lack corroborative evidence that could exonerate Gaetz? Oh, and the hacker data breach. How can documents allegedly obtained by a hacker be verified as authentic? Has the chain of custody for this evidence been maintained, or could it have been tampered with? Gaetz is a polarizing political figure, so could these allegations be politically motivated? Have any of the witnesses or investigators shown a bias or political affiliations that could compromise their objectivity? Are these allegations being resurfaced now because of Gaetz's nomination as Attorney General? If so, does this timing suggest political maneuvering rather than genuine pursuit of justice? So seriously, why were the DOJ and Ethics Committee unable to establish a prosecutable case over several years of investigating? This is an aggressive DOJ, by the way, too, and a guy that they hate. Why has no physical evidence, such as photographs, videos, communications, been presented to substantiate these claims? And let's just say, if Gaetz was unaware of the alleged minor's age, does this mitigate the accusations of intentional misconduct? All reasonable questions that need to be answered if they're going to pursue this thing. In closing thoughts, just something worth considering. And just something worth considering, people try to criticize him, saying that both sides hate him. I venture to think that that might be an endorsement for a candidate. I kind of like when both sides hate a congressman, because that means he's pissing off the right people. And this video highlights that too.
Offered to take us on a tour.
So one of the committees where people have a lot of information is the Appropriations Committee, because they can view almost any vector of government funding. And so, you know, this is Mr. Rutherford's office. He's on the Ethics Committee and the Appropriations Committee. 152 stock trades. Stocks go through the roof. And, you know, actually bought Raytheon stock the day that Russia invaded Ukraine.
Yeah, that's a big one.
Yeah, I mean, imagine if every American could make money off of war.
Yeah, setting aside the whole shame and ethics questions. How many more on our hit list here?
There are a few more. I wish there were fewer on the hit list. I wish we could only stop at one or two offices, but as it turns out,
that information gets monetized. It gets turned into cold, hard cash, and that's a really hard thing to argue against with an idea that would otherwise have merit and make common sense.
whether it's Nancy Pelosi or a few others who have been sort of questioned about this kind of activity, you know, they'll say things like, well, this is a free market and Congress should be able to participate in that too. How is it that they think that they're on, or at least are willing to say that they're on, the same kind of level playing field as the average American?
Yeah, I mean, Nancy Pelosi is on a level playing field from a free market standpoint with other traders in stocks, kind of like Mark McGuire and Sammy Sosa. We're on a level playing field with like everyone else hitting baseballs in the 90s. When you're juiced with extra information, then you have the ability to see the future. And that becomes an incredibly valuable thing in the marketplace. In some of these trades, Nancy Pelosi is making millions upon millions of dollars. And it strains credulity to think that someone could win so reliably and so consistently in the marketplace when they're one of the people who has more information than almost anyone else on the planet.
So there you go. He is asking all the right questions from the POV of the average citizen, but all the wrong questions from the point of view of people in Congress. But biggest thing with this is that an aggressive, hostile DOJ that does not like the Trump administration, does not like his allies, they were looking into this. They dropped it. That tells me there wasn't a whole lot there. But we have to see. I'm glad Trump is sticking to it. I'm sure they did a ton of research into this guy and into his background, to how serious this thing was beforehand. If you want the full timeline of this investigation and this Matt Gaetz information, check out the Forbidden Book Society. That's where I drop my intelligence report PDFs. Thank you for watching. Love you all. See you next time.